You're watching the PBS NewsHour. I'm Hari Srinivasan. There was some disturbing video that made the internet yesterday. It was the murder of James Foley, a journalist that many of us at the PBS NewsHour and other places have worked with. But it also called into question in our morning meeting today how the landscape has changed, because this wasn't the first time. Sadly, this wasn't the first time. There was a video of Daniel Pearl back in 2002 that, you know, change the landscape of how we view videos on the internet. I'm joined by Kevin Convey of Quinnipiac University. He's the chair of the journalism department. So how has the state of affairs changed? Today we actually saw that Twitter and YouTube were trying to pull this video down.
Well, things have changed radically. I mean, to begin with, when Daniel Pearl was killed in 2002, you didn't have either Twitter or Facebook. So the landscape of social media was essentially barren in many ways, and you didn't have this problem to worry about in the first place. That's number one in terms of how the landscape has changed. And number two, you had Twitter get into some trouble because of Robin Williams's daughter being harassed, and so I think that Twitter needed to make a big statement immediately that there is grown-up supervision on the service, and that's why it reacted so quickly to this. But in addition to that, the landscape has changed, because with Daniel Pearl, there was no indication that this was going to be a continuing tactic on the part of a terrorist organization such as ISIS. Now, it's very clear, sadly, that Twitter and Facebook and other social media outlets are going to have to deal with this at least another time, and perhaps on a continuing basis, and therefore some standards need to be, you know, sort of rather quickly adopted to guide them as we go forward.
Okay, just a production thing. Tilt your head down, just, or tilt your laptop down just a little bit. And also, so how, you know, when we think of that video, the beheading of Daniel Pearl broadcast on Al-Qaeda, just old-fashioned, not broadcast on Al-Qaeda, I'm very sorry, the Al-Qaeda video that was broadcast on Al Jazeera at the time, had huge consequences for how we perceive that network. And here we are in an age where it's popping up on YouTube, but then it's not, and then it's coming up on different diaspora social networks. I mean, we're not nearly as concerned about the graphic nature of it. I mean, that was the shocker. And now are we a little bit more immune to it?
I'm not sure whether we are more immune to it or not. It's still terribly, terribly shocking and disturbing. And, you know, the proof of that is how quickly YouTube reacted and yanking it down, how quickly Twitter reacted and shutting down the accounts of those who were attaching images or embedding videos, to the degree that even journalists who were using Twitter to, you know, basically distribute their reporting, were also had their accounts shut down. And that's a, you know, that's a problem, because, you know, Twitter's DNA is openness, and it's difficult for the service, I think, to kind of reconcile that founding idea with the idea that they also need to have standards in much the same way that legacy media does. I mean, if you look at it, what Twitter and YouTube have done is not that much different than the editor of the web editor or the editor of a newspaper saying, you know what, this is way too strong for our readers/viewers, and we're not going to either put it up on the website or put it in the newspaper. It's not that different, but it is at odds with the sort of anything goes Wild West ethos of social media, and in essence, a new sheriff is now coming to town, I think.
So that's going to, you know, push certain people to wonder whether anybody should have that kind of control at all. I mean, they're kind of people who are First Amendment advocates will say, you know what, there is a tremendous amount of hateful speech on the internet, but you can't walk down that slippery slope. If you're Twitter, who is the arbiter of what is in good taste or bad taste or across the line? Who's determining where that line is in the first place?
Oh, thoroughly agreed, Hari. I, you know, it is a huge dilemma. But what is the alternative? The alternative is that the trolls then set the standards, the terrorists then set the standards, and frankly, what Twitter and YouTube are called upon to do is no different than what media organizations are called upon to do all the time, and that is to make judgments about what the limits of speech will be within the context of their organizations. The press belongs to someone who owns one, and the essence is that an organization will have and will express and will work along whatever its standards are. And I think what's interesting about this is that you have gone from a situation where anything goes to a situation where these social media networks are growing up and their proprietors are saying, wait a minute, we don't want to be associated with Robert Williams' dog being bullied. We don't want to be associated with the distribution of terrorist videos showing beheadings of innocent people. I agree that it's a First Amendment dilemma, and as a newspaper editor, I grappled with the whole idea of policing comments, but I finally came down, to the realization that if I fail to police the comments, then the trolls are policing the comments, and that is, marginally worse than the comments being policed at all.
So is this going to be one of those moments where journalism organizations maybe look at their own commenting policies? We did a piece on how comments influence your understanding of the editorial here a couple of months ago, and we were citing a study that said that really the comments actually end up influencing your understanding of what it was. And I think that in that particular case, they used something about nanotechnology, if I remember correctly, and then they compared two groups of people, one who had read comments that were pretty milquetoast, and then one who had read comments that were really incendiary. And so the people afterwards were given a questionnaire, and the people afterwards who read the incendiary comments actually had a totally different viewpoint of the science, which should have been, a non-issue. But in these kind of circumstances, what can these sorts of videos end up doing to inflame public opinion either for or against a particular side?
Well, I think they absolutely can, and I think, it's really no surprise that comments can affect in many ways the way people perceive news stories, because comments are a kind of spin. Comments are a kind of commentary on the basic news story itself, and just as we are spun one way or another by op-ed pieces or opinion pieces or even analyses, so too we're going to be spun, whether willingly or unwillingly, by the comments that are attached to a particular story. And that's one of the reasons why I think it's so important for institutions to develop policies and police the commenting. On the other hand, I'm not sure that this particular development with the YouTube video and the Twitter video is going to make news organizations look at their comments. I'm not sure that they're going to make that connection. I think what it's going to do is to make them want to make sure that they have a strong, thought-out policy about images of violence, images of terrorism, how they respond to complaints by families who don't want their loved ones being shown in their final moments. I think they're going to want to make sure that they have good, solid policies to kind of guide them. But I think that the most interesting thing about this story is that it shows that in 12 years, from the time that Daniel Pearl was murdered until now, that social media is really growing up. 5 years ago, I don't think you would have had this debate about, social media should have standards. You look at lots of the websites. BuzzFeed's a great example that, started out as a click magnet, basically, where what was published was what was going to get the most amount of clicks. Now you have a news operation, you're developing standards, and so you're seeing the internet grow up. And you're seeing adult supervision being wheeled into place at places like Twitter and YouTube, where 10 years ago you wouldn't have seen it.
It was also interesting, and we were talking about this at our morning meeting too, is how friends of Mr. Foley's really started to want specifically, intentionally to change the last image that's seen of him, right? Like, you know, and this coming off of, just in the past couple of weeks, the conversation around Ferguson, one of the most successful hashtags there, you know, was about if they shot me, what would be the image? Would they use the image of me hanging out with my friends and goofing off, or me in a graduation cap and gown? And
sure.
You know, and I personally opted not to watch the video because you can't unsee that kind of stuff. But I remember the image of him in orange, but very soon what I saw on Twitter and social media was really much more representative of his life and how he lived, and whether they were stories he was shooting or whether he was working and somebody had caught a kind of a picture of him, and obviously the words and the remembrances. But it's interesting that we're becoming conscious of that idea that it's not just kids in Ferguson, it's all of us, that, you know, what is our kind of footprint and what are the ripple effects of how we are and how we will exist on the internet forever, even after we're gone.
Agreed. I mean, I think it's really compelling that on the one hand you have the terrorist organizations and the trolls trying to insert this final image on various websites and trying to sneak it by the, you know, the Twitter authorities and so on and so forth. And here is the brilliance of social media and social sharing. You have is lining up to combat that with a plea and a hashtag to remember him with dignity the way he was in life, rather than allowing the terrorists to dictate it. And it's very interesting, this idea that somebody else could dictate the way that you are remembered for all time. And it's scary, but on the other hand, to see the forces marshaled on the side of the journalist saying, here is how we want Foley to be remembered, that's heartening.
Yeah, yeah. I always tell people, especially interns and so forth, Google is your resume. You know, it's
yes.
How search engine optimized will our lives and perhaps our deaths be? Anyway,
very much so.
Kevin, thanks so much for your time. Kevin Combe from Quinnipiac University, chair of the journalism department there, joining us for this Google Hangout on the PBS NewsHour. I'm Hari Srinivasan. Thanks so much for watching.